for 2020 than it was 2020.
Yeah.
So just so everybody knows, Vincent, you need to give the public service announcement.
No, he stepped away for a minute.
He stepped away.
Vincent, he had his moment. All right, so I have the rooms ready to go. So are we all ready to go and choose a name for teams, etc.?
Yep.
Sure.
Hopefully it works.
What happens if we say no?
Susan gets mad.
Well, we don't want that.
Adrian will be fine with it, but Susan, you know, she might get angry.
Yeah. That's okay. She's not here.
I like my new name. You know, it's all good. Okay. I'm going to open all the rooms then because I can do that now. It's so fun.
Adrian.
Yes.
I'd like to apologize. I do not believe I was clear that this week we are Susanless as well, but we have Susan Adrian Gerbeck.
Yes. And we were frantic yesterday, weren't we, Rob?
A little bit, because apparently Susan.
Oh, you froze, Rob. Oh, I guess he left the room.
We'll never know. It's a mystery.
Yes, we started. I don't know how it came up. I think somebody, Karl or somebody, said, hey, the Facebook page, it says only last week. There's nothing coming up. So Susan had to fix that. And then we realized nobody had been asked. I said to Rob, have you been asked? And he went, no, I thought you were doing it. And I said, well, I wasn't asked.
Well, I will help whomever if they need it, but I'm so sorry that I did not realize that.
Well, of course not. But what's happened is Rob had to kind of run things for the first bit because I was tutoring. And then, but Rob has a category. Otherwise, he would do it.
Okay.
So I'm taking over. So we kind of tag team. We're both, we're helping each other and you can help. We're going to get through.
Team trivia. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Now, I'm going to go set up the scores. Yay! I think we're good. All right. Mute and start video.
Hello.
Hey. It's weird how it always does the 60 seconds when it's somebody else who's controlling it. I don't understand why that would be.
I don't know. Is everybody in their rooms or something?
Yeah, they're just being called back. They'll be called back in 18 seconds.
Okay.
So.
Is this for the first round or is it for...
Oh, yeah. You haven't been assigned a room yet, have you?
I haven't been assigned a room.
Yeah, no. We just are picking names.
Okay.
So I will have to assign you to a room. Why is Robin not showing up here? It's weird.
My weird computer vibe. I can mess up your computer.
So yeah, it's strange because it's not allowing me to put you in a room right now. So maybe when I send everybody, I'll be able to do it because you're not showing up in the rooms right now.
Has a fatal flaw. That is correct. Once you make breakout rooms and someone joins this new session, you can't do that until the rooms are open.
Right. Okay.
It is so annoying.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm not going crazy then. Thank you.
Zoom is like the promptness police in that regard. Tisk, 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 tisk.
Well, you know, the bad thing is because if you start to make the breakout rooms when there's only a few people here just to start, you're screwed because you might have doubled the number of people. And then you have to wait and do them all manually instead of just, I can continue the process because no, you can't.
Yeah. Oh, welcome back, Stephen. Stephen was, you were
Yeah, glad to see you again, Stephen. All right.
Thank you very much.
I'll see Stephen. Stephen, there you are. Hello.
Hi, Stephen. Wow. He came back.
He was awesome. He saved the first team I was on last time when he came in. So
cool.
I happened to like pop up and it's just like, oh, I used to do that professionally. So.
Exactly.
It was the programming.
Oh my goodness.
The programming. Yeah. It was really good.
The team they put me on was screwed because I was a programmer and Kyle was a programmer and I didn't join until after that round and Kyle was otherwise occupied even though he was already on the team and didn't make it for that round. So we got a two.
Oh no.
That was the end of that game.
So let's look at our names for our teams. This is, I guess, game number 191, isn't it? It's crazy.
Whoa.
Season 4. I think I forgot to say that last week. So practice makes perfect. So Jane, Kat, Stephen, and Wendy, what is your team name?
We're the Harbingers of Doom.
Oh, no.
Wow. That's very dark.
Said with such a bright cheer.
Is that because you got a package stolen today, Kat?
Maybe. Maybe it's because Kissinger died. You don't know.
That's right. So have you, so does somebody put that into the chat for me, please?
I am doing that right now.
Thank you. And the next team, Ben, Cindy, Peggy, and Rob.
Ben, you put
Santos is alive, but Kissinger is still dead.
Oh, yeah, true. I was wondering if anybody was going to use Kissinger. At least it didn't happen tomorrow. Otherwise, we might have.
Otherwise, we could take credit.
Yeah.
Well, Santos can die tomorrow, though. I think we'd all be good with that.
But
would it be true?
We only have Santos's word that he's alive.
Yes. That's true,
Stephen.
And that might not be true. They're voting tomorrow, and they've got the vote.
Yeah. Well, of course, if Trump died tomorrow, Trumpsters would think
definitely
he was poisoned.
No, they would think he was still alive.
Yes, they would. No, they think that he was going into a cave for a weekend and he'd be resurrecting on Monday.
No one would believe that kind of nonsense.
Gail, did you watch the proceedings today?
No.
Oh, I did. And they voted just by voice vote. It was almost unanimous that he was going to be out. And then he stands up and objects and wants a count. And then they just went on to other procedures. What the fuck is wrong with this government?
Well, they're doing the vote tomorrow, the official vote.
But I don't know why. It was like literally, let's vote right now. No, okay, let's move on to procedure number four, whatever.
Well, interesting. And
there was no explanation of that because, of course, they know what they're doing, I think.
The MSNBC broadcast his response to it, where he basically said, I'm just like Trump, I don't believe anything. I'm guilty, and they're just making me a victim.
Disgusting.
Yeah, so on that note, let's go on to Janine, Jim, Carl, and Ramiro. Team three.
We are name in our hearts and our prayers for answered.
Okay, we said Kissinger's name in our hearts and our prayers were answered.
We're taking credit for it anyway. Leonard.
So if we keep
Kissinger obviously was the thing this week. You've got more coming up.
Oh yeah. I was thinking there was gonna be at least one, and I guess I'm psychic.
They might be all.
I'm so psychic. Okay, let me see. For Carolyn, Jamie, Kevin, and Leonard, let me see. It's Trump for president of Oz. No heart, no brain, no courage. Am I correct?
Almost.
That is stunning.
That is amazing.
Absolutely stunning. How did
give her $1 million?
I mean, know that.
You mixed up the brain and the heart order, but other than that, that was impressive. Yeah.
I even read it correctly. It's president. If you look at the chat, right? It says Trump for president.
President.
Yeah, president.
President of Oz. I think it was a typo.
So you have a different one than we do.
Oh, okay. Because the one that Kevin put into chat when we first came back.
Right, was different.
Yeah.
So is that now a precedent?
Yes, it's a precedent. Yeah. Oh, there's the right one. Thank you, Kevin. But I just had to kind of play that up. All right.
That's an unprecedented claim.
I had to giggle more. You know, that's what it was. All right, Gail, Karen, Lee, Ron, and Vincent, what have you got for us?
Well, another Kissinger one. Kissinger proves only the good die young.
Very good.
That's a good
sense
one.
Of theme
like
to the evening.
Yes. So what we have tonight for game number 191 is Harbingers of Doom. Santos is alive, but Kissinger is still dead. We said Kissinger's name in our hearts and our prayers were answered. Trump for president of Oz, no brain, no heart, no courage. And finally, Kissinger proves only the good die young. Well done.
So it's a harbinger of doom?
Harbingers. Yeah, there's... That's right.
Harbingers versus Kissingers.
I never said I could spell.
My wife told me Kissinger died. I said, really? I thought he was already dead. That's how irrelevant he was to me.
Was like, well, he's been rotting for a couple of decades, but apparently still alive.
Somebody finally drove a stake through his heart.
So who were the stakeholders on that?
All right, so let's get going with our round number one, and I believe it's Wendy Hughes. You're up, correct? Now, be kind, everybody. This is Wendy's first time doing this, and she's so everybody, you know, be patient. Now, I've given you your superpowers, Wendy. So you
No, don't do that to me.
The superpowers are the most fun ever, Wendy. You get to snoop on all the other rooms. It's great.
So do we have some kryptonite to use on Wendy?
Wendy, if you like, we can fling you around to rooms if you don't want to get the controls.
Oh, I'm already confused enough. I mean,
we'll help you out, okay?
I had a paper jam in my printer the other night, and I was like, oh no.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
So what's going to happen is you'll tell us what your category is, and then Karen is going to mute everybody, but unfortunately that will mute you. You know how to unmute yourself, right, Wendy?
Yes.
Perfect. So give your category, and then Karen will mute, then you unmute, and then carry on. And I'll help you out anytime you get stuck with what to do.
Ms. Facilitator, I am noticing that I am not a co-host. So that's another little step to do.
Thank you.
Zoom is not cooperating tonight. Zoom.
It is not.
That's never happened before.
Deborah
entered the waiting room.
Okay, we will get her here.
Okay.
There we go. So what is your category?
Rocks. Okay.
Ooh, rocks.
I would venture to guess that many people in our game are familiar with Don Prothrow. How I met him originally was that because I'm in Los Angeles, I could go to CFI, which was in Hollywood. They had a physical plant in Hollywood, just 7 miles from my house. A little bit farther east is Pasadena, and Skeptic Society had their when they used to have meetings, you know, they were at Caltech. Yeah. In Pasadena, and it was a hop, skip, and a jump. Really good parking, and it was nice. And Donald Prothrow is personable and friendly and welcoming and easy to, you know, he's very approachable. And what I learned, like in these years since, is that if I had understood what geology was about and the relationship between dinosaurs and geology, I might have become a geologist. Unfortunately, it was like kind of too late. I had too much other stuff happening in my life, but I could read the books.
Wendy, I'm going to mute everyone, and then you unmute yourself and continue with what you'd like to say. We're going to mute in 5, 4, 3, 2.
I'm unmuted.
Awesome. Okay. Good job.
Okay. So I bought this book, and I think I'm doing this my topic differently than other people have in the past. Like I went through the book and I just picked off what I thought were topics that he covered. He's a funny guy, and that I thought would make interesting questions. And so I just picked them all out of this one book, which is not a new book. It's a couple years old. And it was such a struggle to type out my questions and answers. So, and then some of them are pretty stupid, but you know, the game is supposed to be fun, right? So now I go to the
can you find the chat?
Yeah, I'm looking for the chat.
Should be at the bottom.
Yeah. And to everyone.
Yes. Good.
My first question, or number one, it's not exactly a question. It's multiple guess. I'm asking for you to pick a definition from the A, B, and C that are in the chat. The definition of uniformitarianism, a progressive religion similar to Quakers, B, geologists should wear uniforms in the field, and C, natural laws and processes that operate today must have operated the same way in the past. This is different from supernatural catastrophes, such as the biblical flood catastrophism, to explain natural phenomena and the existence of fossils because they could not be subjected to test and examination by evidence. So I forgot the process. Like, do I just go through like all of my questions at once? And then
no, if you could put them in the chat first and then read them, that would be great.
Oh, okay.
So put it in the chat, then read, then put it in the chat. You know, just one question at a time. Does that make sense?
Okay, yeah. It does. Perfect. I just am nervous.
No, don't worry. Take your time.
It's just you're doing great. And absolutely. Wendy, you're already successful because we all know this category rocks.
Rocks.
I'm sure if everyone wasn't muted, Karen, there would have been a collective groan there.
Because the category does rock. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yes. Thank you. Because I'm having like serious stage fright right now.
Okay. I understand.
Okay, thank you. Okay. So then the next one is...
Yes, she is a rock.
Okay.
Before you put the next one in, could you put the first one in so we can copy it?
It's there.
No, you probably sent it to somebody individually.
Oh, then. I see what you're saying. So
yeah, so make sure it says to everyone. Like it said, there's a little drop-down thing.
Okay.
Yeah. We got it.
You guys see it?
It now. Perfect. Yes.
Okay. So the second one is when huge boulders are found in locations where there are not similar rocks nearby or balanced in unlikely positions and parallel scratches are gouged into the surface of bedrock, the explanation could be A, rocks carried along in water by the biblical great flood, B, rocks lifted by a tractor beam and dropped in random locations by extraterrestrials, or C, rocks carried from their point of origin by global ice sheets during periods of glaciation. Alan Steiner entered the waiting room, it says. Okay.
I'm pretty sure two is a trick question.
Don't let them in.
And that's one thing that Karen will be watching out for, and probably Rob as well, because I gave them both powers.
Yeah, okay. I actually let him in as soon as I saw the pop-up, although I don't see him on my screen, so he might be on my second screen or something.
Okay.
Thanks, Rob.
You guys are going to find out how corny I really am inside. Number three. Although not the first scientist to speculate on the explanation for similar fossil species found geographically far apart and the congruent coastlines of South America and Africa, in 1926, Alfred Wegener proposed this idea at a meeting of the American Association of Petroleum Geologists. It was not accepted until 40 years later in the 1960s. A, continental breakfast, B, continental drift, or C, Lincoln Continental?
I think there's an answer missing. D, Christopher Walken as the Continental.
or D, Lincoln Continental drifting.
Okay, here's another one. Four. Tech breakthroughs directly related to the space program, except one. A.
We did not get four.
Oh, excuse me. I'm sorry. There, I forgot to click. Okay. Four. Okay, A, smaller, faster computers, robots for assembly lines, artificial hearts, thermal blankets, better drugs grown in zero gravity, smoke detectors, earth shoes, air purification systems, UV sunglasses, joysticks for video games, better golf balls, disposable diapers. Okay, let me go get the next batch.
So just to be clear, we're supposed to pick the one that, that wasn't related to the space program.
Right. Thank you. Don't hesitate to ask. If some of this is screwed up, I'm sure it's my fault. So anyway, and not Donald Prothrow's. At the beginning, this is...
You just put up 6. Is there a 5?
Oh, did I miss something? Wait a minute. 3, 4. Excuse me. Good catch. Thank you. Let me see what I did wrong. Oh, I have to go back to another document. I did something wrong here.
You might as well talk to 6 since it's in there, and then you can put 5.
Yeah, I'll leave that there. Thank you, though. Oh, yeah, and this is a good one, too. Please bear with me for a moment.
Yeah, don't worry about it.
That's okay. While Wendy is doing this, we'll all make note that Faith has joined us and she is apparently freezing.
Oh, and I also, I have a question.
We greet you warmly.
And I have a question for Rob. Are you there, Rob?
I am.
Yeah, I want to copy and paste into the cells in the spreadsheet. Yeah. But the A, B, C, and D ABCs are all going into separate cells. How do I get it so it doesn't do that? It didn't do that last week. I don't know why it's doing it.
Go up to the top banner,
yeah,
instead of the cell itself.
Yeah. Oh, paste it into there. Gotcha.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. So
thank you.
Backwards, the question 5 is following the question 6, but I'll ask it anyway. 5. Lunar rocks brought back by the Apollo missions were not similar to the early Earth in composition, nor were they an exotic composition as if they had been a body from outside the Earth captured by gravity. Instead, they were made of an orthosite and its volcanic equivalent, the familiar black lava known as basalt. In other words, the moon was formed long after the Earth had cooled and coalesced, and its layers had differentiated and separated. The only way to get a lot of mantle material, the only way to get a lot of mantle material into space was a really, really powerful volcanic eruption hawked like a spitball into space. B, in impact with another body that knocked a chunk of Earth into orbit, or C, an asteroid with a remarkable similarity to Earth got caught in Earth's gravity and has been orbiting ever since. So you get to pick. Now, going back to number 6, at the beginning of every new year, especially after year 2000, the world's most precise clocks need to be adjusted to account for the moon's tidal pull on the Earth gradually slowing the Earth's rotation. Otherwise, they would be out of sync with atomic clocks by A, 1.5 milliseconds every century, B, 5 minutes every century, or C, 1 second every year. Okay, now I have to go back and get number 7, right? Okay. This one's kind of cool, in my opinion. 7. The Earth used to spin faster. There were 400 turns. That's in parentheses, Earth days, close paren, in one revolution around the sun, as measured by growth rings of fossil corals. They have growth rings like trees have growth rings. Earlier, 600 million years ago, the day was only 21 hours long, not 24 hours, 430 days per year. True or false? Then number 8 somehow got on here. I didn't mean to. It's good too. 8, the Rosetta Stone is a slab of black granodiorite discovered in the Nile Delta in 1799 by a soldier during Napoleon's conquest of Egypt. It has been on display in the British Museum since 1802. The Rosetta Stone is famous because it has 3 versions of the same message in 3 different languages. A, Greek, Chinese, and Egyptian hieroglyphics. B, Latin, Sumerian, and Greek. And C, Greek, Demotic, and Egyptian hieroglyphics. I learned stuff when I was doing this that I didn't know before. Mm-hmm. Okay, now I need to go and get 9 and 10. Okay, I'll just get 9. Some critics think that science is about planned research to achieve some specific goal, making simple predictions and then finding an answer through experiments. But many of the greatest discoveries in science happen by stumbling upon some unexpected result, serendipity. The following list includes 11 accidental discoveries, parentheses, or useful in unintended ways, close paren, period. Which was not? A, gelignite, the key ingredient in the development of TNT. B, superglue. C, Scotchgard. D, rayon. E, penicillin. F, aglets. G, LSD. H, Viagra. I, electromagnetism. J, the planet Uranus. K, microwave ovens. And H-I-J-K-L, Corningware. Just a minute, I'll go back and get. So, oh, that was one also that you pick out the one that doesn't fit.
That was an accidental discovery versus something that was they meant they were looking for, right?
This is one of these serendipitous weird things. I was rewatching The Crown, the series, and one of the earlier episodes is titled Gelignite. And I had never seen that word before, and I had to look it up.
Ah,
so, yeah.
I haven't heard it before. I didn't understand
what so, it was. Yeah. So anyway, we picked...
Like all of these, except for one.
For one, yeah.
Was...
were accidental.
Useful.
Yeah.
That was discovered and followed up. That was an accidental observation.
Yeah, it's interesting. Thanks.
And that instead of, like, people think a scientific researcher has an agenda to start with.
Mm-hmm.
And what Donald Prothero is saying is that it's not like that. It's that a lot of great discoveries were really discoveries. They were not, nobody was looking for them. They just, like, somebody noticed a cause and effect relationship.
Yeah. They were looking for something else, like a route to Asia when they stumbled across a continent.
Yes.
That's and a good for people who've been playing this a long time, a lot of those were I did twice, unintentional discoveries.
Yes.
Those were in there.
That's right. That's true. Yeah. So we should get this one right, right? Still tough. It's interesting.
Elsa, yeah, go ahead, Wendy. Not all of them were, so.
Yeah.
And then my last one is number 10. Earthquake weather is A, hot and humid. B, cloudy with a chance of meatballs. C, there is no such thing as earthquake weather.
Oh.
So those are my questions. You guys are going to get to talk about them while I go try to organize the answers.
So if you want to send Ed, do you want to try and send everybody to the rooms? You just go and look down at the bottom. And you look for something that says breakout rooms. If it doesn't say breakout rooms, there's three dots that say more, and you click on that.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Hit breakout rooms, and it should open up a little dialogue box.
Okay.
And then send to breakout rooms or something like that.
Open all rooms.
Okay. Thank you. Open all rooms. Thank you.
And Wendy, let's you and me stay here a minute, and we'll talk about moving you around to different groups.
Oh, I don't want to do that.
I'll do it for you if you'd like.
Okay, yeah.
There. And you need to put me in a room.
Yes, I can do that. So Wendy, you can worry about...
Put her in room 5, please.
So Wendy?
Yeah?
What I can do is I can just send you to a room and you can just observe, and then a little later you'll just magically appear in another room and you can just kind of peep in on people. I'll just fling you about.
Oh, thank you. Okay, fling me about.
So Robin is still not showing up in this.
To me she is. Where would you like to assign her?
Well, I can see her over in my list over here, but oh,
I'll assign her if you tell me where.
Put in waiting room. I can see put in waiting room. That's weird. What's going on with that?
I'll go ahead and put her somewhere if you tell me where you want her to go.
Yeah, I was just wondering why it's not coming up on mine. I've got host privileges, so it's very strange. What room? Oh, let's put her in room 4.
4, there you go.
Am I being put in my place?
Oh, and Ron, or Alan, we have to put in too.
And Deborah.
Oh, and Deborah.
And Kevin needs to go back wherever he came from.
Oh, there. I see the unassigned now. It's now popped up. So I can put people into.
Hey, Wendy, I'm going to send you to a room and you can just observe quietly and enjoy the delight of what you've done here.
And Kevin, you know what room to go to?
Room 4.
Yeah. Are you on a sign? Is it not working?
I had to leave and come back.
Gotcha. Okay, I sent you to room 4. Are you good to go now? And Deborah and Alan, let's see. Let's put Alan in room 2 and Deborah in room 1. How's that sound?
Sounds good. Thank you.
So much to do. Yeah, suddenly everybody just popped up and above. So I don't know. It's weird.
Okay.
Don't forget, Adrian, recordings in progress.
Okay, thanks for the announcement, Vincent. Welcome back, Vincent. All right, Wendy. So if you want to show us the answers, are you able to put them in the chat? Did you figure that out?
Oh, I need to be able to figure out what's going on with my monitor. So, okay. Because...
Or you can just do what a lot of people do, Wendy, is just read them first and then worry about putting in the chat later.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah.
I can, because most of them are ABC or whatever, I can just type them into the spreadsheet and then I can copy and paste them into the.
Figured out what's going on here. Okay.
Anyway. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So.
So if I. If I make up a bunch of questions for a setup, I just make some Word documents and do cut and paste into chat. Yep.
That's right.
Yeah.
It's relatively simple.
Yeah. Can you hear me now?
No need for them to be Word, just whatever.
Okay.
Application it doesn't have to be with. Word. You can use whatever.
Yeah, I think it's easier to put them in Excel and you can just rip out a whole line.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Go ahead, Wendy.
What if I go through these? I wanted you all to know that I picked off the questions that I thought were going to be kind of fun to discuss, and some of them were kind of, I don't know. I heard you guys talking about it, and it was such a rush. That you were taking it so seriously. And thank you very much. So the definition of uniformitarianism, excuse my corny jokes, but the answer is C, natural laws and processes that operate today must have operated the same way in the past. This is different from supernatural catastrophes such as biblical flood, that's called catastrophism, to explain natural phenomena and the existence of fossils because they could not be subjected to test and examination by evidence. And what I did was, in my answers, you'll see when I post them, it's Prothro, page 41 in the book, in my copy, the paperback edition. I put at the top of my answers. It's the story of the Earth in 25 Rocks, Tales of Important Geological Puzzles and the People Who Solved Them by Donald Prothro, Columbia University Press, paperback edition 2020, and then the ISBN number. And so when I'm putting the page numbers, these are the page numbers in this edition. Okay, so number two, when huge boulders are found in locations where there are not similar rocks nearby or balanced in unlikely positions and parallel scratches are gouged into the surface of bedrock, the explanation is C, rocks carried from their point of origin by global ice sheets during periods of glaciation.
Right.
The biblical flood was the most popular theory, but Swiss geologists at the time had seen glaciers in action. According to Prothro, that was page 320.
And of course, people living near where I do, I'll know about the Okotoks Big Rock.
I don't know what that is.
Okay, it's quite a large glacial erratic a little south of Calgary.
Okay, see, I have seen photographs of rocks my whole life that were stacked in a funny way and never understood until now that it was because, well, I guess I knew like little bits and pieces of the story that they would be picked up by glaciers and be carried, far away, and the glaciers would melt and time would pass and they just became part of the environment.
Yeah.
When they didn't belong there, they were in places where they didn't occur naturally.
Sometimes it's Wile E. Coyote who does it, though.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I remember my father talking about visiting a farm in Nebraska, and that his brother had bought, and they were walking around, and dad, let's see, maybe his brother pointed out, or maybe my dad knows. Good Lord, there aren't any rocks in the soil. That's weird.
All right, Wendy, number three.
Number three, although not the first scientist to speculate on the explanation for similar fossil species found geographically far apart and the congruent coastlines of South America and Africa, in 1926, Alfred Wegener proposed this idea at a meeting of the American Association of Petroleum Geologists. It was not accepted until 40 years later in the 1960s. And the answer is B, continental drift, not one of the other kinds.
I love the continental breakfast.
Yes.
Well, it can't be that. That's from earlier than the 1960s.
And if the Lincoln Continental drifts,
those are fun.
You need bearings on your wheels,
yeah,
or check your brakes or something.
So, Wendy, just for expediency, if it's a very long question, you don't have to read the whole thing when you're giving the answer. Yeah, it's the one about this, and the answer is yeah.
Okay, so anyway, I just wanted to point out that when this was accepted finally, when Wegener's theories was from the mid 1920s, it was the 1960s. I was in high school in the 1960s. In my lifetime, it was finally accepted and being taught in geology classes, when I went back to school.
Yeah.
After my daughter was born. And we'll move on to number four. Tech breakthroughs directly related to the space program, except one, Earth shoes.
Yay! We sussed it out.
Yeah, we did.
Okay, and then the lunar rocks brought back by the Apollo missions were not similar to early Earth in composition. And what Donald Prothrow did was he went through this whole long explanation about the time sequences and the development of the Earth toward what we think of like the ages of the Earth and the changes taking place in it. And and about why this made a difference, and that that it wasn't aliens. B, an impact with another body that knocked a chunk of Earth into orbit was on page 116. And number six, at the beginning of every new year, this is for real. And the answer is 1.5 milliseconds. Me getting an email. Every century, it adds up, says Prothrow on page 121. Number seven.
Neil deGrasse Tyson said
it's different,
though.
Can you give the
ladder? Excuse me?
That's A.
A team, math A. works.
Yeah.
Yeah, except that there's been one almost every year since they were introduced.
Mm-hmm.
Well, he's saying it's, I could go back and read it to you, but basically he's saying that it is trying to make up for the drag on the this comes into it. This number seven is related. The Earth used to spin faster. There were 400 turns Earth days in one revolution around the sun and blah, 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 blah. True or false? It's true. Eventually, the moon and the Earth will not only be tidally locked and much farther apart, but their motion could come to a halt. However, this is billions of years in the future, and the sun will probably explode before then and wipe out the inner planets, so it will never actually get
to Earth. Did he say explode? Because I don't think the sun's going to explode.
Well, expand.
And the motion can't stop.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Basically, you'd have the Earth rotating at the same rate that the moon is going around the Earth, so that they're both. So that
there's no phases.
Yeah.
No, they'll still be phases.
They'll still be phases.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, they'll be like
Jim, hang on. Go ahead, Wendy.
Okay, I looked up tidal locking, and I have the, because I didn't know what that meant, but it has something to do with like the moon and the Earth are going like their relationship will change.
Yeah. Yeah, like the moon is now tidally locked to the Earth. Rotation of the moon is now tidally locked to the Earth, so that there's the same face always looks at the Earth, and way in the future, the same side of the Earth will always look at the moon.
And I don't think there's enough time for that to happen, is what she was saying.
Yeah.
So, and then also he mentions that song Dark Side of the Moon. That's not how it is. That's not how it works.
Yeah. Anyway. It's the far side of the moon, not the dark side.
Well, that's a song though. Okay.
Yeah.
to make a long story endless, number 8. The Rosetta Stone is a slab of black granodiorite. Blah, 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 blah. The Rosetta Stone is famous because it has 3 versions of the same message in 3 different languages. The right answer is C. Greek, Demotic, and Egyptian hieroglyphics. And this is Donald Prothero, page 244. Demotic is the name of a cursive form of the language of Egypt. The stone was finally deciphered by French archaeologist Jean-François Champollion in 1822. When he did so, he found the key to hieroglyphics and, by extension, to ancient Egyptian history. That was kind of interesting.
I thought it was Vulcan, Klingon, and English.
There you go.
That was D.
Right.
For the Klingon, I believe that was the Rosetta Stone.
Leonard, that was in the Mirror Universe. So,
yeah. That was good, Stephen.
That was really good.
All right, Wendy, go ahead.
Some critics think that science is about planned research to achieve some specific goal, making simple predictions and then finding an answer through experiments. And I made a list that I copied from the book, and then I inserted aglets. The exception, aglets. Aglets were originally made of metal, glass, or stone, and many were very ornamental. Wealthy people in the Roman era would have their aglets made out of precious metals such as brass or silver. Before the invention of buttons, they were used on the ends of the ribbons used to fasten clothing together. Sometimes they were formed into small figures. Shakespeare called this type of figure an aglet baby.
So I have a question for Leonard. My recollection of the discovery of Uranus, am I wrong, was that they were intentionally looking for it because of the perturbations of the other planets?
No, that's Neptune.
Neptune.
Ah, okay.
They were looking for Neptune because the orbit of Uranus didn't fit correctly.
Yeah. Yes.
Go ahead, Wendy. Sorry. Wait, just a section. Go ahead, Wendy.
Oh, okay. It's just like those little.
I was thinking electromagnetism was.
Anyway, number 10, earthquake weather is none of those other things. It says, there is no such thing as earthquake weather. A careful analysis of quakes in almost any region shows they can happen at any time and any season, with no preference for hot weather, cold weather, or any particular time of day. This is because earthquakes occur many miles underground, while the daily fluctuations of temperature are not felt more than a few feet below the surface. Quakes are unpredictable. Over 50 years of experience has taught seismologists that no two quakes are alike, and precursors that might warn us of one type of quake are useless for another, with no precursors. Another factor is the deep psychological shock of finding out that terra firma beneath our feet is not, in fact, so firm, which shakes us to our core. Prothro page. He is the funniest man, and he makes jokes about geology. And that's his thing, and he's really nice. And Heather and I, my friend Heather, who came to SciCon, and she's just my dearest girlfriend, that we went to a Skeptic Society conference, and one of the highlights of the conference was going to Vasquez Rocks. And Donald Prothro taught us all about the uplift, these funny rocks that they look like, I don't even know how to describe it. They look like they're like stacked like a deck of cards, only they're rocks, they're huge, and you can kind of climb up on them, and he was telling about if someday there's going to be a great big honk and earthquake that's going to separate Northern California from Southern California. And those of us down here in Southern California, we're not going to get any water. So I hope it doesn't,
I hope it doesn't happen soon.
But, I mean, like, there's some fun things about knowing a geologist and then some horrifying things. So,
yay, Wendy! First time for it. Yay!
Ooh, well done, good. Wendy.
Excellent job.
So, let's see how well Wendy. Your team did. Okay, team number one, the Harbingers of Doom. Hopefully, it wasn't doomish.
Well, we rocked out with an 8.
Oh, that's good. Rocked no out.
Kidding. How far out, you guys?
Well done. Okay. And Santos is alive, but Kissinger is still dead.
9.
Ooh. And we said Kissinger's name in our hearts, and our prayers were answered.
10.
Ooh. Oops. Hang on. I put that in the wrong cell. Hang on.
Answer 2.
Do you feel like a proud mama, Wendy, when you hear these scores?
I am tickled beyond words, and I thought when I was doing this, when I was assembling these questions, it was such a struggle. It was so hard to do, and then it turned out to be fun.
It is fun. It's great. You did a great job. All right, Trump for president of Oz. No brain, no heart, no courage.
10.
What was that?
10.
9.
10. Whoa, 9, 10? Which one?
Yes, we had 10. Which one do you think we missed?
Wrong team.
We're 9.
Okay, gotcha.
We're team 5, Gail.
All right.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought we were team 4.
There's just, Kissinger approves only the good die young is team 5, and you got 10. And we is that correct? 10. Awesome.
Yes, sorry about that.
So average of 9. Oh, I didn't share my screen. Oh.
Well, that's okay. You're actually following Susan's lead. She never shares the screen on the first one.
Yeah, she never shares the first round anyway.
I don't know why, but she doesn't, and that's her thing.
She assumes we're all listening and therefore don't need a reference.
Anyway, average of 9.2. So there we go. And up next, Rob, are you ready to go?
I indeed am.
And is it going to be about Noah's Ark?
Well, sort of. So it's going to be about this thing, which is the Ark Encounter, which if people joined us for recovering from religion, which I know some people here did, they're going to have a leg up because Ross Blocker did a talk on my invitation about his trip to this, I'll call it a travesty. And he talked we'll for about muting. An hour. We had questions
muting
about
in
it.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Okay, so
You can use that title, the Ark Encounter, Adrian, and I am going to ask you to answer these questions about the Ark Encounter. And this is a Christian Young Earth Creationist theme park. The centerpiece of the park is a full-scale representation of Noah's Ark based on the Bible's flood narrative. Question number one. In which U.S. state is the Ark Encounter located? Number two is... Ken Ham, CEO of Answers in Genesis, which people might remember that guy from the Bill Nye debate, founded the park. In what country was he born? Number three. Which of these answers most closely matches the cost to construct the Ark Encounter according to Answers in Genesis in U.S. dollars? 10 million, 50, 75, 100, 150, or $200 million. Pick the closest one. Number four. In what year did the Ark Encounter open? And I'm not going to give a plus or minus on that. Number five. The Ark Encounter opened on July 7th of whatever year that was. This date was chosen to correspond with Genesis 7:7, the Bible verse which reads, "And Noah and his sons and his wives and his sons' wives with him." Finish the sentence. I'll be generous regarding your answer. You just need to get the gist correctly about what they're talking about. Number six. What is the length of the ark at the Ark Encounter? I'm going to give you plus or minus 20%, and you can look at that picture once more behind me for a little idea. That is actually it from their own website.
Can we give it in cubits?
Yeah, I want it in feet, sorry. Number seven.
What is the volume of the ark in cubic cubits?
This is a true or false here. Well, no, actually not true or false. I constructed it. Yes, no, it is true or false. Okay. The ark includes many kinds of animals shown in cages, collected to survive the global flood and repopulate the planet. Are any of these animals pterodactyls and non-avian dinosaurs? Number eight. The Ark's private security guards are armed with what type of weapon as they make their rounds and monitor the behavior of visitors to the Ark? Tasers, handguns, they carried no weapons, or they had both of those types of weapons? Number nine. A geological history display within the Ark shows there were what number of continents on Earth at the time the flood began, with Earth's current continental configuration being directly caused by the flood. Take that, Donald Prothero. Number 10. There are plans to add another large-scale theme area to the Ark Encounter based on which Genesis story? And because some of these are really hard, I'm going to actually break Susan's rules, especially because you're not here. I'm going to give you a bonus, which is worth a point, as long as you don't. You know, the max is 10. But you can use this point for a point if you don't have 10. The story of Noah's Ark featuring Donald Duck is told in a segment of this 1999 Disney film. You must provide the full name because it's a bonus, so I'm making it hard. And that's it. Any questions?
That's fun. And I'm going to be just like Susan. I know one.
Oh, no. Yeah, yeah. You didn't put anybody on my team who was at the meeting on Monday. So, this is not... All right. Go to your rooms.
Me.
We accomplished nothing, except we got ourselves automatically muted.
Yeah.
I don't know why it does that. Sometimes it doesn't, which I find odd.
I think it's a host setting.
Yeah.
Oh. So
we're not being jerks when we come back in.
It's that.
Give us a moment to take a deep breath. So you have the next set, Karl?
Yes, I have round 3.
Any hope for us?
Well, virtual reality.
Now that you know what team you have, did you play to Adrian?
I didn't play to anyone.
Oh.
It looks like it's virtual reality. About virtual reality.
No, no.
It's movie themed.
No.
It's always movie themed.
Is it Keanu?
No, there is no movie or pop culture theme to this.
Okay. Oh, right. Okay. If it's movie themed, I wouldn't be any help anyway. So I guess it doesn't matter that I'd be bowing out at this point.
Janine, you technically at least have a chance of at least one right answer, but I don't guarantee you'll get it.
Technically, I have a chance.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you put a lot of faith in me. Now I'm anxious. But Romero will know it anyway. And so we'll
see. I don't know.
I don't know what a pop culture.
But we'll see after I do the round if I should have put more hints in or not.
Yeah. More hints are always good. Romero, what do you do when you go to work? What kind of job?
He sits right here.
He sits right there.
This is where we're working.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, I'm I'm a programmer.
Okay.
I'm a developer.
Okay.
I come in here and harass him a couple times a day when I'm
home. Yeah, she works down the hall.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we used to have another co-worker here.
Of the feline variety.
I remember that.
She didn't know she retired.
Okay.
I keep telling him it's time that we get 2 new co-workers of the furry four-legged kind.
That would make sense.
Get a pair of litter mates.
Yep. He says no. But
really?
Yeah. Because we'd have to get a cat sitter and we're going on a trip next month and we'd have to get a cat sitter.
Well, wait till you get back from next month.
You can't take cats on a run with you normally.
Yeah, but
a dog you could.
Yeah, get a dog.
Dogs will not happen. No.
All right. Ready for the answers?
No.
Yes.
Yeah, fire away.
All right. Seems like most of the teams were doing somewhat reasonably on this. And it was interesting. Both of the people here that I know came to the Recovering from Religion talk were in the same team. It worked out that way.
How dare they?
I think they probably got the best score. All right. Number one, the state. It is Kentucky.
Wow. Oh,
boo hiss.
Please tell me you got that, Janine and Romero. Because that was mentioned a lot of times.
Yeah.
All right. Ken Ham is from Australia. Thank you.
Oh, oops. I'm sorry, team. I thought he was from New Zealand.
Thank you, Adrian. Okay.
We didn't know the answer.
Yeah.
Number three. According to this came up a bunch at the meeting. We were Googling it, trying to find numbers. The biggest number we found anywhere was 120 million. So the answer is 100 million, which is deep.
Yes. Thank you, Peggy. Good job.
Much of it by taxpayer funds. So the wonderful year that the world changed in a lot of ways is the same year the Ark opened, 2016, when Trump became.
That was a good guess.
Good job.
The beginning of the dark times.
Yes.
Yeah. Good thing we didn't change it.
The verse in the Bible reads, and Noah and his sons and his wife and his sons' wives with him. Of course, horrible writing, by the way, in that whole book. He said it. And Noah and his sons and his wives and his sons' wives with him went into the ark to escape the waters of the flood.
Oh dear. Okay.
So if you just go went into the Ark or whatever.
Yeah, we put boarded the Ark. Yeah. I'm assuming that's
fine.
Good.
That's fine.
Okay, cool.
As long as you don't say like started to build it, you know, or exited the Ark, which I heard people talking about.
Right.
Because this was the opening of the Ark Encounter when the first people were going into the Ark. You get it? All right.
And all the T-Rexes and the
yes,
pterodactyls.
So there was some clue to one of these because you can see the Ark in our picture.
Yeah, I didn't turn the light out yet. I have to go back up.
Can hear you, Deborah. Mute yourself. So that should have given you some range if you looked at the other things nearby. And the answer is in feet, 510. The range is 406 to 612.
Woohoo!
Yes, just got in there. Just squeaked by, team.
Well,
go Canadian football eyes.
And that was from some, you know, understanding of the word qubit, which has, I guess, some controversy about it, but that's what we came up with.
Yeah, there's no firm.
And the volume of cubic qubits.
So there's a question about, were there non-avian dinosaurs and pterodactyls in there? And yes, despite what most Christians even believe, that the dinosaurs died before the Ark, no, Ken had them all brought on the Ark. Now, if you try to ask why there are no dinosaurs now when all the animals got off the Ark, I guess the lions just had a good snack. Because I don't get it.
Have you ever had a pterodactyl?
Ate the dinosaurs and the
tastes like chicken. Number eight. So number eight was interesting because Ross showed photos and included pictures of the security guards, which he found a little intimidating because they had weapon on their belt. And he said, I think they're tasers. And then Kara, who actually is the host of our meeting, said, no, I was a police officer. That's a firearm on the left and a taser on the right.
So both. Great. Wow.
Nice.
Yeah, because, you know, it's Kentucky.
So in keeping with their gentle Christian nature.
That is correct. Both. You touch a pterodactyl behind the bars, you're
you gotta be ready though for the devil that comes.
Yeah. Number nine. So this is another thing that Ross showed us in one of his shots. I had not seen this anywhere else. They showed the earth before and after the flood, and it was one big continent, which is how all the animals just walked onto the ark.
Yes.
Yeah. But that doesn't explain how they
got back. Yes, no.
It does not.
Number 10. So I heard a lot of interesting debate about this between a few other things that are in Genesis, but they actually have a nice depiction of what they plan in the future, and it's a very high tower. The Tower of Babel.
Oh, no.
Sorry, team. I thought it was...
And they would be bringing some stuff from the Ark Encounter. The Ark, besides having animals in it, actually has a lot of museum exhibits, one of which is the world's geology, and one of them is all about how the languages got spread, and it's all the story of the Tower of Babel. Yeah, so they would just move that out and put it into a separate place.
Yes. Wow. Yes, the creationists don't believe in linguistics either.
Nope.
I'm sorry, Rob. What did you say for number nine?
One continent.
Okay, thank you.
Yep, and the bonus is I actually watched this because people might not know Ross is actually an employee of the Mouse. And he's got his credit all over a lot of feature films, including Wish that just came out or is coming out. And so he told us about this. And I had never seen either of the Fantasias, but I, in fact, after he said it, I watched Fantasia 2000, which has freaking 10-minute segment with Donald and Daisy going on the Ark, and and it's to the music of Pomp and Circumstances. Interestingly, so you can picture the animals walking to that.
Donald and Daisy.
We had Fantasia Redux.
No, called Fantasia 2000. Sorry,
Fantasia Redux.
And interestingly,
it's more like Fantasia 4 Ducks.
Put the answers in the chat. I'll put the answers in the chat. I'm not going to make you have the slash because Ross says that is how Disney writes it, but it's never written anywhere that way, including on Wikipedia.
Interesting.
I have the DVD right here. It just says Fantasia and then 2000 underneath it.
No slash. Very weird.
My favorite Disney movie.
So say, I saw the original Fantasia a few decades ago. And
as did most of us.
Yes. I had never seen it, so I watched both of them back to back.
I never saw the new one.
Well, all but two of us.
Doing a clean sweep.
Yeah.
Let's do the scores. And I will remember to share my screen.
There you go.
So, Harbingers of Doom, what did you score?
Just a sec. I don't see anything. No, I'm kidding. I do.
I think we managed to pull out a whopping 4.
Yeah, I think so.
Sorry.
We didn't even get a bonus point for being cute with our name. We knew it was the re-release. We just didn't know it was.
All right, Santos is alive, but Kissinger is still dead.
9.
Rob's team. 9. Yay. See, I helped, Rob. I helped.
Thank you. Consistency.
And Trump for President of Oz. No brain, no heart, no courage.
We had 9.
Nice. And I guess we'll go with Kissinger proves only the good die young.
9.
Ooh. And we said Kissinger's name in our hearts, and our prayers were answered.
All 10.
Whoa.
Oh.
Whoa. You're pulling ahead.
Whoa.
I guess it's break time,
sorry,
huh?
Dean. I feel so bad that I got the country wrong. That was
what country? You said New Zealand.
I said New Zealand.
That's so
you're in the right hemisphere.
Vincent, we didn't know what it was. That's okay.
So close.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's okay. And I don't know why I knew that, but I did.
Thank you.
From listening to the Skeptic Zone.
Yeah, maybe. It must have been. I wouldn't be surprised if it's made it in a few newsletters over the last 2 years. I wouldn't be surprised. All right, should we do the picture, I guess, before anybody
picture time.
Goes? Picture time. I'm ready to go when everybody else is ready. 3.
I can get into my
2,
space helmet. No.
1.
I want to see Ben in
what
the space
happened
helmet.
To it? Okay, why didn't it work? Oh, geez, weird. Okay, I got to do that helmet. Again because
it just looks
really
like a fancy
delayed.
Chair behind you, though.
I know.
Ah, the heck. So I'm going to do that again. It was really delayed. I don't know why it took so long to do anything. So 3, 2, 1. Why is it not doing anything?
0, -1. Oh, it's 2.
Good enough.
Making my
waiting
cheeks
for
hurt.
You to look into it.
So most people held it long enough. It's good.
Oh, okay.
Boys and girls, so I spoke to my child today. He's heading to Prague, I think, tomorrow. And he's meeting, I don't know who, what her name is, but there's apparently a big skeptic person in, you know, of the group in Prague. So he's meeting with her. And he found out that in Leipzig there is a museum of like a pharmacy museum, and it also has part of it a homeopathy section. So he was really excited about that. So he missed all kinds of trains and connections, trying desperately to get on time over to the museum so he could buy something in the store to bring to this skeptoid in Prague, but it turned out they didn't have a store there. But he thought that you guys would get a kick out of the homeopathy part of the museum.
Who would know the difference?
There you go.
It's much more
the powerful. Water museum.
Interesting.
Traveling with drugs.
Hey, is it Claire Klingenberg?
What I don't know.
Oh.
I don't know. I'll have to find out. I'll
how
right,
are you
five minutes. I have to
I'm, right. I'm good. We both survived.
Yeah,
both,
Susan, 5 minutes. Is that 20 minutes or should we do 5 minutes?
It's fine.
sometimes it's I set my timer and I come back, it's not done yet, and she's already middle talking.
Yeah,
I sometimes
she
5 minutes
cuts it
is
off
2 minutes.
Too quick. Yeah. We need at least the full 5 minutes, if not like
all
7
right.
minutes.
Anyway, sounds good.
Bye all.
Okay, bye.
Adrian, do you guys want me to put the questions in the or the answers in the chat?
I actually got them all, so we're good.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
You did a great job of reading them out, so it's no problem.
Thank you.
Hey, what was the length of the what was the length of the of the ship?
The Ark.
It's in the chat. It was 510 feet.
All right. Oh, so it was 600 was too big.
No.
We are in there. That's right.
408 okay, cool. to 612. So it was perfect.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah. What did you say? 610.
We just said six. We just decided it was about two football field lengths. That's what we judged it on by football fields, you know, because that's
American football.
That's an American unit of measure, from my understanding.
The football field?
And that's what I was suggesting, too.
A football field is a half an arc long.
Yeah, but it's two football fields, not just one.
That's right. That's how you measure it, though. Right? I mean, how many times in the news it was two football fields long or three football fields?
Every time I've measured an arc, it was in football fields.
Hey, was it Canadian, American, or European?
We did American.
Yes. Yes.
All right, there it is.
Well, I really love European, Karl's Europeans, background. Europeans don't play proper football. They kick things.
With their feet.
Yeah, who would name a sport football if you use your feet?
Right.
Yeah.
It's just crazy talk. Just I know. Crazy yes. talk.
These people that like don't even know what continent to live on. And then there's this silly story that people like us came to the Americas from Europe. But if Europeans came to the Americas, why are there still Europeans?
QED.
I think there's just a vast conspiracy to make it seem like Europe is still populated.
Well, I think that thinking is clearly not something that is relevant to this conversation.
In the Ark experience, I'm curious, are pictures of, oh, they would they have, no, it's not, I forgot, it was like with Noah, what part of the world was that in? Would Noah have also been of Middle Eastern descent?
Correct.
Right. So would he be also like Jesus, blonde hair, blue eyed?
Of course.
You're muted, Cindy.
Now, Noah's mainly long gray beard and gray hair.
At birth, right?
I always remember seeing him depicted as an old man. I always depict him as an old man.
I don't know what his category is going to be, but Karl has chosen a background that's really scary.
Oh, vampires. Nofenstrahl. Whatever. No, that's Adrian. That's Adrian.
That's yeah. Susan.
Yeah.
I think is that Keanu Reeves? Kumar.
That's Keanu Reeves.
That's Keanu Reeves.
Oh.
Yeah.
Looks like he's putting on the.
I think that's from Johnny Mnemonic.
Correct.
Oh boy, I've never seen that movie. Shit.
I haven't either. Maybe that's why I didn't know what it was. It looks scary though.
It has nothing to do with the movie.
Okay.
Good.
Oh, so is Leonard here? Leonard, question. So were you disputing the age that Prothero had in Wendy's answer?
The age?
the age of the difference in that and in the speed of the Earth's rotation in millions
for
of
the
years
time ago? Adjustment.
Yeah.
Yes.
Interesting.
Okay. Yeah. No, he's just wrong. And you can tell it's wrong, because if it was 1.5 milliseconds per century, then why would you add a second?
Oh well, let me see what the exact quote was.
That's interesting. So we assumed that the difference of whatever it was 5 hours and millions and 600 million years was correct, and based our calculation on that, and we got the 1.5 milliseconds. So that's interesting. So yeah. Maybe that was wrong too.
No, or maybe he made the same mistake, because it's a perfectly
that's
logical mistake.
That's what
but
I said.
But
yeah.
the actual facts are much more distorted than that. It's a very strange story as to where the leap second came from.
Hmm. Let me see if I can find
it. And I also don't know why he said, like, especially after 2000, like, what does that have to do with anything?
Yeah, okay. It's just weird.
So, Leonard, what do you think it is?
It's none of them are correct. It's roughly 1 second, one leap second per year. Leap seconds were introduced in the 1970s, and there have been about 30 of them in the last 50 years. So it's roughly a second per year.
That's what I thought the answer would be.
That's what I thought. I knew about leap seconds. So,
yeah, I didn't know about leap seconds, but why would they do it every year? And we have tides every night. There are tides.
Well,
every
tides
night.
Have nothing to do with the.
Well, that's what what's the way the question read, Leonard. That's the way.
Yeah,
the
tides have to do the tides and tidal friction are different things. So what we think of as tides happening every day or twice a day is a related phenomenon, a closely related phenomenon, but it's not the same thing. The tidal locking, which is what this is about, is a continuous thing, not doesn't go up and down.
The leap seconds is something totally different. A leap second is because if you take 24 hours a day times 365 days a year, you're off slightly by a second per year.
No, that's not right. No. We can talk about it offline, Lee, but
fair enough.
The tide is high, and I'm holding.
No, talk about it now. I want to hear the conversation.
No.
No, I think it's time, actually, to do announcements. Is there anybody with any announcements? Rob, who just left?
I'm here. I have nothing to report.
Nothing to report. Wow. And I have a little bit to report. I guess I don't know if you guys have been following Susan and Melanie's adventures down in New Zealand and Australia, but there are some videos coming up on YouTube now about, including Melanie's talk and Susan's talk. I think Melanie's, I'm not 100% sure about that one, but definitely with Susan's. I saw a panel where Susan and Melanie were talking in New Zealand, which is really good. So check those out. Check out YouTube, and I know Susan's posting stuff all the time, so you can check out.
Yeah, is this Susan? There was the panel talk. I watched that, and also Susan's presentation is up somewhere. I watched that too.
Yeah, she's got a long presentation, and she has a shorter one that she did more recently. So she's got a couple presentations up now. So check those out.
And
they're really good.
She did a TikTok video with Melanie also posted.
Yeah, it was really good. Yeah. About gorilla skepticism. And anybody else have anything?
I have something that's not really an announcement, but I've been reading a fiction book by one of our fellow skeptics, which I've really enjoyed. It's Mark Crisplick's book, Skeptics in the Pub.
Oh.
Cholera edition. And it's a dystopian novel on a very interesting premise that England won the Revolutionary War.
Oh, interesting. So
the U.S. is colony, still a colony. Oh. And it's a science whodunit mystery. It's
I love that.
Oh, that's the worst thing about that is we probably would be using centigrade.
That's a well, that was one place where I cringed that somebody paid in dollars instead of pounds. So I have a few things to bring up with Mark.
Can you post that, Janine, into the chat? The name of the book? Sure. That would be great. And I'm going to also talk about a book because I interviewed this fellow this week for the Skeptic Zone, which is really great. And it's Does Coffee Cause Cancer and 8 More Myths About the Food We Eat. And speaking of fiction, it is done, read as a fiction with some romance in it, but talking about math and science procedures and why people who are in the media get things wrong and why 1 minute coffee causes cancer and the next minute it actually cures everything. So he goes into all these details and I really enjoyed it. I don't know, maybe I'm I'm simple or something.
It, it depends into which orifice you put it, because if you drink it, it causes cancer. But if you use it the way Gwyneth Paltrow likes you to use it, then it cures everything.
There you go.
Who's the author?
The author
is put it in the chat.
I will definitely do that. It's Dr. Christopher Labos, and he is from he's got a podcast. He's Canadian. He's from Montreal. And he and Jonathan Jerry, they have a podcast, and I've just gone totally blank on it. And I know it, and I listen to it. Oh, good grief. And it's a fun podcast. And the book is like this. It's got, if you, Body of Evidence is their podcast. And the book has kind of cheesy comedy in it. So just be prepared. But I like that. I liked it. And when it ended, I wanted it to keep going. So I will definitely put that book into the chat. And I thought it was a really good read. So.
Cheesy humor can be a real good time.
It was I giggled a few times. I definitely giggled a few times. Speaking of giggling, there's a couple giggles coming up on this week's Skeptic Zone podcast because I'm reading the newsletter, the Australian Skeptics newsletter, because it makes sense that a Canadian would do that. And Richard is back in Australia and has some things lined up. So make
mostly
sure you listen.
Lorikeets in his tree.
What's that?
Mostly yes. Birds in the tree outside his studio.
Oh my goodness, the studio. Birds. The birds in the tree.
Yeah, is that something new for his area?
No.
He's been complaining about that for years.
Wow. Yeah, he will often have to get up at 4 in the morning just so he can record without the bird sounds outside.
Wow. Have you heard, Adrian?
Have you heard?
Here we go.
Bird is the is word.
The word, yes. I couldn't help myself.
Yeah. And I have to say, when we were in Australia, the birds are noisy. I complain sometimes about the birds outside here, but no, I can. Vincent, twittering, I can still record.
I have to say, Vincent, now I know you're completely recovered from your surgery.
Yeah.
Am I? I'm not completely. I still am not able to lift 10 pounds. So
the dad joke organ has recovered.
Yes. Maybe that doesn't, that happens first. Maybe.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, it is a vital organ.
Yeah.
Oh, there's the giggles. Okay. I guess we should carry on. And who's up next? I believe it's Karl. Is that right?
Yes.
Awesome.
So he's facing forward, so it must be.
I need to give you your powers, don't I? Oh, I already gave you your powers. Gave you your powers already, so that's awesome. All right.
So before I start, Janine, in all fairness to Mark Crislip, the Spanish milled dollar was kind of the standard of trade in the colonies.
Oh, was it?
Yes.
Okay.
This is one of the reasons why we adopted it as our currency, because it was already well understood by people.
Oh, thank you. Because I kind of just went wrong for me right there, but that's because I knew too little.
All right. I think Leonard figured out what my background is there, but my category has nothing to do with any movie
my category has to do with mnemonics.
Oh.
So I will give you a mnemonic, and you answer what the mnemonic is for. And I'll give you a few pieces of information here. For instance, you don't have to be ultra specific. If I give Roy G. Biv, you can answer the colors of the rainbow or the colors of light visible spectrum. You don't have to be super detailed, and you don't have to list all the individual colors. I will give you a couple more pieces of information here. One, for most of these, it's a fairly typical mnemonic, and you just pay attention. The capital letter in each word is meaningful. But in number seven, it's a different kind of mnemonic, and you don't go by the capital letters. And then finally, all of them, except for number 10, fall under one of the following categories: science and nature, technology, mathematics, or geography. And so, now, we will begin. And I will mute everyone. Boom. Everyone else is muted. I am not. And here we go. Number one, I'm actually going to give you two mnemonics for the same thing. My very energetic mother just served us nachos, or mean, very evil men just shortened up nature. Number two, oh, be a fine girl or guy, either one of those words works, kiss me. Number three, I couldn't pick a favorite again, so I'm giving you two different mnemonics for the same thing. Dear King Philip came over for good soup, or dirty kinky people can often find great sex. Okay. Number four. Harry, he likes beer by cupfuls, not over frothy, never nasty mugs allowed. Since past six closing, are kegs canceled? Number five, I know at least one person here should know this one. It's two of them again. Either, please do not throw sausage pizza away, or in reverse order, all people seem to need data processing. Number six, superheroes must eat oats. Number seven, how I want a drink, alcoholic of course, after the heavy lectures involving quantum mechanics. Number eight, please excuse my dear Aunt Sally. Number nine, either some old hippie caught another hippie tripping on acid, or sighs of happiness come after having tankards of ale. And finally, number 10, God's excellent love never dies. This is the one that is not nature and science, technology, mathematics, or geography. And now we will find out that I probably should have given you a category for each particular one, because it's probably way too hard, and I apologize. I will now send you to your breakout rooms.
My team was
voguing.
Was amazed that I was on last week, recovered so quickly. I even amazed the nurses at the hospital that I was able to walk on my own.
Yeah, right away.
On the day of the surgery. So
and we're amazed you're here for round three too.
Very, very good. Yeah. Now. Your lighting makes you look like you're a suspect.
I know. But what can
we're
I
hiding
do?
His identity to protect mm-hmm.
He's hiding. He's like, is it really Vincent?
It really is. It's that there's no light in front of me. That's why I'm mm-hmm. up against a wall.
Well, it's good you're here. All right, Karl, let's get those answers going.
All right.
So Vincent, I'm sitting at my computer and there's no light except for my computer mm-hmm. monitor on my face. So there's me something. Too.
No, maybe. it's the laptop. The laptop just.
No, but I'm saying it's the same circumstance. So I don't know why. There's
but Rob, difference. What time of day is it there?
It's dark. So there's no light. There's very little light in the room.
Anyway, let's.
Anyway.
Yeah, go for it,
I'll
Karl.
I'll do a PowerPoint with the answers and then I'll paste the answers into the chat.
Mm. Thank you.
So. We start here with number one, the names of the planets in the solar system. There used to be a slightly different one that included the letter P, but of course that's not there anymore. Number two, stellar classification.
All right.
Oh, I bet I know somebody who knew that one.
Mm-hmm.
Number three, the order of taxa and biology.
Oh, we thought of that, but couldn't get there.
Number four, the first 20 elements in the periodic table.
Yay.
We got that.
Helium, lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, neon, sodium, magnesium, aluminum, silicon, phosphorus, sulfur, chlorine, argon, potassium, and calcium.
We should have had that.
Yeah.
The great thing about this round is if you didn't know these, but you know them now, you can do better in someone else's trivia round in the future. You know, I can name the first 20 elements.
Yeah, of course.
Number five is the OSI network layer.
Yep. Yay! We got that.
Woo! We should have known.
Lee and Ron.
Yeah.
That was, of course, the first one I answered.
Nerds.
Yeah.
No, I left off the plea.
I was a data communications engineer. There are some things that are just hardwired. Yeah, into you.
Yep.
Number six, the Great Lakes in order of largest to smallest, but you can just say the Great Lakes. You don't have to have the largest to smallest.
Good job, Peggy.
Yeah. We got it.
The first 15 numbers of pi can be remembered by counting the letters in each word of the phrase.
I thought it was something about coffee.
How I want a drink, alcoholic, of course, after the heavy lectures involving quantum mechanics. You can know pi to 15 figures.
Wow.
That could be useful in trivia someday.
Well done with Faith, I believe, who got that.
Nice.
So Ron Blocker has like this down to
Is it Romero? Oh.
Which one? I think it'd be easier to memorize the numbers than that.
So Ron Blocker has this in the thousands of figures. Yeah. How does he freaking do that?
I have no idea.
No way.
Too much time on his hands.
Number eight, the mathematical order of operations.
Oh, PEMDAS. Yeah. I should have thought
that. You got it.
Dang it.
Number nine. The
number
basic
nine.
Trigonometric functions. You can just say trigonometry.
Sokotoa.
That'd be fine.
What if I said Sokotoa?
Sokotoa would be fine. I know.
Trigonometric
you know
ratios.
Yeah. And number 10, the first five books of the Hebrew Bible or the Torah or the Pentateuch or the Christian Old Testament, depending how you want to refer to it.
And that's the one you were sure I'd know, right? Oh, that's the one you were sure I'd know, right?
No.
Yeah, no. Well, that was, I figured you'd know a lot of it. All right. There's
I think our team got a pretty high score.
All I can say is thank goodness I was on Leonard's team.
I helped my team by leaving the room, and every time I left the room, they got an answer.
Yeah. I figured it out.
Did you leave it 10 times?
Nine.
Maybe she did.
I got one.
Yeah, she got Sokotoa for us.
Because I use the mnemonic "Old hippies are high on acid," which is pretty close to that one.
But you're not an old hippie, are you, Adrian?
That's why I'm not high on acid, I guess.
Yeah.
He's too young to be an old hippie.
Okay, I guess I need to share my screen now. Again, here we go. So we will start with the Harbingers of Doom.
We got eight.
Woo, good recovery.
Yeah.
And Santos, Santos is alive. Got nine, is that right?
No,
we got five.
Got five. Okay. And Trump for President of Oz, no brain, no heart, no courage.
Eight.
Very good. And Kissinger proves only the good die young.
Eight.
Nice. And Carl's own team. How did you do?
We did it again. A 10.
Holy cow.
Hey.
Wow.
Hey, I'm screaming over here. Can you hear me?
Now I can hear you. Yeah. Why were
got
you 10.
Screaming?
Who?
Yeah, Trump for president.
Trump for president got 10?
Yeah.
That better?
I don't know who called out 8.
Okay, well, we've sorted it out. We're all good.
I thought for sure that Carl's team wouldn't get 10.
Wow. Because Susan Adrian Gerbic was on it?
No, because Carl wasn't on it. Because
Carl wasn't.
Yeah. We have a pretty diverse team. We had a bio.
Yeah, you're right. Somebody else would pick it up, but I didn't think you'd get a 10. Good job.
Well, I did help. I got one.
Yeah.
And I got 2 for the record.
And then she left.
Good job.
Thank you, Susan.
Jean got 2.
Yeah, and leaving helped.
I think we would have got a 9. I knew 1 and Leonard knew 9.
And if anybody's interested, the answers and the questions are in the chat as a document you can download if you want them. Because I know they're in such demand.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
I think I would have individually, I would have only scored 3 if it was just me.
Yeah, I would have got 1. Well, I might have got a couple more, but that's hard.
And Leonard would have got 9, maybe 10. I don't know if you knew the one that I, one of the ones I knew.
If I had thought to write out the letters,
yes, then you would have got it.
Sokotoa.
Yeah.
I didn't think of doing that.
All right. So I guess Jamie's next. And I need to give him his superpowers, don't I?
Well, I have an iPad, so I might need some of your help.
Yeah, no worries. You let me know what you need me to do.
Hey, give them a good one. We can't have a perfect score from anybody.
No, I think this is basically, I think it could be quick and simple.
Oh, no.
Okay, the category is classic American TV game. So you need to match the game show with the original host. And I emphasize nice. Original. Okay.
Mm.
So let me give you first the list of the game shows, then I'll give you the list of the hosts that you match.
Oops.
Okay, all set? Okay, the game shows are number 1, Watch My Line. 2 is Press Your Luck. 3 is Joker's Wild. 4 is Family Feud. 5 is The Price is Right. 6 is Super Password. 7 is To Tell the Truth. 8, Concentration. 9, I've Got a Secret. 10 is Jeopardy. And I give a bonus of The Wheel of Fortune. And you have to match it to these hosts. Okay. So the hosts are: A is Bert Convy, B is Art Fleming, C is Bill Cullen, D is John Daly, E is Gary Moore, F Richard Dawson, G is Bud Collier, H is Hugh Downs, I is Peter Tamarkin. J is Jack Barry. K is Pat Umsejak. L is Gene Rayburn. M is Chuck Woolery. N is Tom Kennedy. And O is Dennis James. It's that simple.
So we have 15 answers and 10 questions.
Yes. Okay. So Adrian, can you help close, open the rooms up?
Are any repeated?
No, they're all unique. No repeats.
All right, here we go to the rooms.
Okay, thank you. Okay, everybody's back?
Yep.
Okay. Let me, I'll give you the answers and then I'll post it on chat. All set?
Sounds good. Yep.
Okay, I'm going to share.
One more team. See.
Everybody's back? Okay, can anybody see this?
Yep.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so number one, what's my line? Is D, John Daly.
God, Bennett Cerf. Jeez, yeah, I reckon. Yep.
Number two is Peter Tamarkin, 2I.
Oh, yeah.
Three. The Joker's Wild was Jack Berry, 3J.
Wow.
Sorry, team.
Four F, it's Richard Dawson for The Family Feud. I think everyone got that.
Mm-hmm.
The next is The Price is Right, 5.
Yay.
Is Bill Cullen.
Wow.
5C.
God damn it.
The old show. Six, Super Password was Burke Convey, 6A. To tell the truth, 7 is G, Bud Collier.
Kitty Carlisle.
Yay. Yep. Hugh Downs was the host of
Oh, he did do a show.
Yep. So 8 is H. I've Got a Secret was Gary Moore, 9E. And Art Fleming was the first host of Jeopardy, 10B. And the original host of The Wheel of Fortune was Chuck Woolery.
Wow. Chuck Woolery,
M. Yeah, it wasn't Pat Sajak, it was Chuck Woolery.
Man, that was a tough one.
That was interesting, though. It was really...
okay.
That was good.
Yeah,
just, down memory lane.
Jamie, was... would you like to share what you found out about your grandmother?
Yeah, my grandmother was a friend of who was it? Gail told us. Bud Collier. Bud Collier was a friend of my grandmother.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
I didn't know. Gail said, "Oh, I didn't know."
Yeah. Cool.
She used to talk about it.
Yeah. I know that my father was a good friend with Charlie Adams, the inventor of the Adams family.
Yeah, they were in the army together.
Yeah.
Funny, one of my friends was on the Price is Right, and I didn't know him at the time. And then years later, he showed me a video. I said, oh, yeah, I've actually seen that show when that happened. I just didn't know he wasn't my friend yet when he was on. Mm. And then my uncle was on it once. He won a few prizes.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
So, Jamie, if you could put the answers into the chat for me, I would appreciate it.
Yep.
Thank you. So, great category. I guess we need to get the scoring.
Bill is not here tonight, but he's a Jeopardy champion.
First time.
Yeah.
Who?
Bill.
I was a definition champion for all you Canadians.
Ooh, I remember definition.
5-time champion, too.
Yay!
Wow.
Ron, do you remember Rick Moranis? You remember the actor Rick Moranis?
Oh, yeah.
His parents were on The Price is Right, and they won some stuff, but they never, he was still a kid, Rick, and they didn't tell him, but they won a big TV. So I think he found that out when they were watching it on television.
And he was my classmate, by the way.
Yes.
Oh, really? Oh,
yes. He and Geddy Lee were both in my class.
And wow. Geddy Lee, now that's a claim to fame. That's pretty cool.
Ron, say the name of the show again. I want to look that show up later.
It's called Definition. It was really popular in Canada about 15 or 20 years.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And actually, it was a real good show.
Yeah.
I even remember that show. God. Yeah. Some I remember.
Maybe. All right, everybody. Let's start off with the Harbingers of Doom again. What did you get in this round?
Two.
Is that what we got?
I don't feel so bad now.
Between 12. We got 12, a solid 12.
we're still sliding. We got a 4.
Okay. So that's the Santos is Alive group got a 4. Mm-hmm. All right.
Correct.
And so the next team we'll go to is Kissinger Proves Only the Good Die Young.
Oh, we had 8.
Bonus. I think we got 9 because we got the bonus.
That's how we got
8. Yeah.
I saw we only missed 3 and 7.
We missed
another one.
We missed 3, 5, and 7.
Oh, yeah, 5 also. Okay, I missed 7.
All right.
Okay.
So we had 8.
8.
Hey, take 8.
Good. Got 5. A lot of old TV watchers.
We got 5.
Okay, so. Trump for president got 5.
5.
Okay. And let's see if the 10 streak carries on with Kissinger's name.
Somehow we got 7.
Still
respectable, though.
Oh. Yeah. It
was a miracle.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jamie. The good category.
Yeah. He had a category. Wild guesses.
Susan would be very proud. She likes the 5, 5 averages.
Yeah. Oh, good.
All right, so the last person I believe is Ron doing the the bonus.
Yep.
So I better give him his superpowers then.
I think our team is in trouble now.
And don't let the thing give you a hint here.
Letter rip.
Your
round is going to be the death of us all. Is that what you're saying?
Could very well be.
The harbingers of doom are.
I absolutely guarantee that this category definitely might make a difference in the final score.
Oh
no!
Oh yeah, it's got to be so hard on us, Ron.
The category is "You're Dead to Me" 2023 edition. I am going to give you a list of 27, because I like nice round numbers, people. 10 of them died this year.
Oh, Lord.
Of the remaining ones, they either died last year or they're still with us.
Ooh.
You need to figure out who the 10 people are who died this year.
Very is that good. The lunar calendar, or
it's not even the Jewish calendar?
Very good.
2023. So
awesome.
I'm going to hopefully I can do this all in one big list here.
Does that include people that died in December 2023?
What if they're just mostly dead?
Yeah.
Oh, you're funny, Leonard.
And
if they die tomorrow, can we get more points retrospectively?
Yeah, if they died in the last 2 or 3 days since I put the list on, I will give it to you if you can give me proof that they've died.
That's fair.
So you need to death certificate
before the end of this round and kill them.
You need a death certificate or will TMZ come?
I'm on Harbingers of Doom. I'm considering desperate measures.
Yeah, okay. our team died.
So here
the
20
was prophetic.
Here are the 27 people. As I said, 10 of those people died in 2023, and the remaining ones either died in 2022 or they are still with us.
You have some people on this list that you should not have on here, because if they die, I'm blaming you, Ron.
Yeah, that's good.
Oh my God.
There we go.
Add Donald Trump.
I was always going to put Kissinger on there because I couldn't believe he was still alive when I put the list together, but obviously that would work well. Okay, so I guess I'm getting ready. I mean, sending you guys off to your rooms. There they
are. Excellent.
All right. Off you go.
Thanks, Ron.
You deserted your room. Oh, here they come.
Yeah, I thought it was at the very end.
Okay, does it look
so
like
so, Adrian, before we get to answers, we need to populate next week for round two.
Thank you very much. So, we need some people for next week.
I can do a category or the bonus.
Okay.
I prefer a category, but I'm willing to be flexible.
I've got a bonus ready to go, so I'd be willing to do that.
All righty then.
190.
Okay, Susan, Adrian, I'll take one. It's been a while since I've done one.
Okay, awesome. So Karen, then we've got Gail at the bonus. And who was that? Was that Lee?
Lee,
yeah.
Nice. Okay. So I've got Karen, Lee, and Gail. Did I miss anybody?
I can do one.
I'm psychic. I knew you were going to say that, Kat.
Kat, it's great. I can't wait for your category.
Adrian, I have some ready.
You're going to be psychic at least three or four times tonight. You're not ever going back to Las Vegas if you keep that up.
It's Susan's influence. Now, who is
thinking of the number five? Am I right?
That was Peggy.
Peggy. Thank you, Peggy. We are good. That's perfect. Everybody. So thank you, Karl, and thank you everybody else for.
I almost didn't think of it either.
See, we're a team. Susan remembers all this. But I guess help her out.
Do we want to be super good kiddos? And when mom gets home, we've filled part of the next week as well.
Yeah, I've been kind of doing it every other week, so I could do one then.
Yay!
All right, let's go on to the next game.
I'm sure I can come up with one.
Okay, hang on a second, you guys. You're going too fast. I have to actually... I have to add more rows. Oh my goodness. How many rows will it actually let you do?
Add a million rows and see what happens to the spreadsheet. It explodes.
It just had to add 1,000 at a time. So. Yeah. That's what it did. It just added 1,000.
I had to do
rows.
That when I hosted last time too.
Okay, so
Rob and Karl.
Rob and Karl perpetuating the fact that they're almost never in the same team because they're both in every other week on trivia rounds.
Yes, that's right.
Well, there's some.
Kevin?
Great. Yeah.
All right, Kevin, you said you do one?
Yep.
Yeah. Awesome.
Not a bonus, a regular round.
Regular round? You got it?
Yeah.
Anyone else for 2 weeks from now?
If it's
we're
2 weeks.
Doing the bonus next week, I'll do a regular one the following week.
All right, Gail?
Vincent is also chiming in.
And Vincent, do you want to do a bonus? Or is that too past your bedtime?
Oh, no, not a bonus. I'm not.
Well, we could do the bonus in the first round if you want to sleep.
Oh, I like that idea.
Not a bonus.
You know what I mean?
No, he doesn't.
Or would you rather do a regular round?
Just a regular round, please.
Okay.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So I have to take somebody out then.
It doesn't matter to me. If you want to push me to another week, that's fine.
Okay, perfect. I will do that. I'll put you to the next week then. Kevin, thank you for doing that. That's
no problem.
Nice of you.
So this is 2 weeks from now, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. We'll remind you.
And then put Susan on one of those too.
But don't tell her.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, put her name for an entire week.
She's already got a bunch prepared, though.
Make up a Saturday or something like
that. Let her just find out by looking at the list.
and put like the Saturday date.
That would be really fun.
Saturday 3 a.m. Monday 3 a.m.
All right, I think I got this going now. All right.
All right.
So I've even got one person for 3 weeks from now, which is Kevin, which is great. Okay, so we need to share. Oh, we have to first get the answers, don't we?
Yeah.
You can make up numbers if you want.
Yeah. I mean, we really don't need it.
We can really try and be psychic.
Everybody got 10.
You just project based on what we've got before.
Everybody got 10. I like that. I like those thoughts.
Okay, so I'm going to do this in reverse order just to build the suspense here. So the first thing is, I'm going to give you the four people who are still with us. Mm-hmm. So Anne Margaret, Dick Van Dyke, June Lockhart, Ron. And Tippi Hedren.
Ron, can you give the number that was associated with each person?
It's on the
it's in the chat.
It's in the chat.
Okay, well, let's
Number so go ahead, Ron. Sorry.
Yeah, 1, 6, 10, and 25. I mean, eventually I'm going to give you the final 10 people that you're really looking for. So those are the four that are still with us.
I didn't think Dick Van Dyke was dead yet.
Yeah, and I've been threatened that he dies in the next few days, next week, I'm in deep doo-doo.
He's old, but...
He'll be charged with capital murder.
Yeah, 100.
Here are the ones who passed away in 2022. So as I'm going through this, if you put those people down, you're in trouble, because here are the correct 10 people.
Darn it.
Sorry about Barbara.
Yeah.
She died on December 30th.
And you'll read them for the list.
Yes. So these ones are number four. Number four, Cormac McCarthy. Number five, Dick Butkus. 8, Gary Wright. 9, Glenda Jackson. 16, Pat Robertson. 17, Paul Rubens. 21, Richard Roundtree. 23, Sinead O'Connor. 24, Suzanne Summers. And 26, Tony Bennett.
These are the people who died this year.
Yeah, so those are the 10 answers I was looking for.
Where does that start?
Who is Cormac McCarthy?
He's an author. He wrote The Road and various other
books. Passenger, a couple of other books.
Yeah.
And who's Gary Wright?
Gary, he was a singer.
Dreamweaver.
Yeah, Dreamweaver.
Our love is alive. That guy.
Yeah.
I'm sorry if any of people who love those individuals are watching this video. I live under a rock.
Yep.
The Road is a very good book. It is dystopian and very sad, but it is one of my favorites.
He's quite dark. Yes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes. All the Pretty Horses, Blood Meridian. Haven't made myself read that one yet.
No Country for Old Men.
Yeah.
That's a harsh one.
That was a harsh one.
If I got this right now.
They put that into a movie, didn't they? No Country.
Yeah, I saw the movie. I haven't read it.
They did.
Scars.
They also did The Road. That went into a movie, too.
That was supposed to be very good.
Yeah.
Scars. Suzanne Summers.
Book is even worse.
somebody wake up Susan so we can get scores.
Yay!
I was fixing a mistake I made.
Oh no.
I know. All right, are you ready to go?
No, because I can't see my scores. I haven't finished scoring yet.
Okay.
Oh,
so Suzanne Summers was very generous on her show. She was one of the trendsetters for making sure that there was equal pay for ensemble cast, even though she was the one that was getting all the big bucks in Three's Company, she looked out for her colleagues.
And unfortunately, she also spread a lot of bad information about medical stuff.
Well, that
was all over the skeptic world.
But as an actor, she did a good thing.
So are you able to see that now?
I got it. Kevin, I got him also.
All right. I'm almost done correcting my mistake that I made here. So just give me, I don't know.
You did okay.
Yeah, we're almost, there we go. Okay. All righty. So I'll share my screen again. And we will start with the Harbingers of Doom.
We got a 7.
Woo!
Yay!
Great recovery. And in Santos is alive, but Kissinger is still dead. How did you guys do?
We also got a 7.
Oh, interesting. And Trump for President of Oz, no brain, no heart, no courage.
Get 8.
No.
No, we got a 7.
That counts. Stop.
Gail, you keep thinking that
you keep answering to the wrong team.
I keep doing the wrong team. I'm sorry.
We got a 7.
7?
Yep.
And
Okay, Gail's team. Gail.
Nicely done. So let's see how Kissinger's name in our hearts and our prayers were unanswered.
Got a 7.
Wow.
Wow. Exciting. I'm happy.
Second place.
Lucky number 7, apparently.
Yeah.
So the Harbingers of Doom were correct. They were in the basement.
They were. Right? So, good scores.
Adrian, we will see you
tomorrow.
Tomorrow morning or tomorrow afternoon.
Afternoon. Yeah. Sounds good. I'll text you.
Okay.
Good night. Thanks for hanging out for so long.
Adrian.
Bye, everybody. Good
job, Adrian. Adrian. Bye. Put the title of the book in the chat.
I forgot to do that, didn't I?
Thanks for your leadership,
I was
Adrian.
Interested in it.
It's a fun book. I liked it. Myths about food. The food we eat.
All right, 1 a.m. here. Bye, folks.
Yep. See you. Bye.
Good night, everybody.
Oh, shoot. I sent it to Karl.
Okay, I'm looking for it. It's not there.
It's not
Karl
there.
Karl really wanted that title.
Okay.
And the author.
Yep.
Ah, got that. All right.
Christopher Labos. There we go. In fact, I can probably, if you just go to Amazon, they sell it. I'm sure Barnes & Noble will have it. Whatever. If you can't find it, you can always contact me too.
And you know if it's on Kindle?
I would imagine it was on Audible. So I would imagine if it's on Audible, it's on Kindle as well.
What was the other book that we talked about tonight? Wendy's Rock book or something?
Oh.
Donald Puthero?
Donald Puthero's
probably
book?
In the chat.
What's the guy's name?
Puthero.
Rock Hudson.
Sorry.
That was good.
Careful, Karen. You that might be treading so on a future good. Round that I might be working on with people who with rock in their name.
Ooh.
Goodness. Okay. Well,
she kept saying Donald or something, and I kept
saying everyone.
Trump. Good night.
Good night. Good night. There's the other one. Skeptics in the pub.
Good night, Robin.
One. Good night.
Good night. Good night, Jane.
Good night, all.
Jane, how are you doing?
Good night, Ben. I'm doing fine, thanks.
Okay. Hadn't heard from you. I was going to text, but
yeah,
I'll see you in a week or so.
You guys know when Susan's coming back?
Maybe never.
Never.
Because I'm thinking next week will be interesting.
Vacation from us.
We don't have anybody looking after us next week unless she's here.
Yeah, I wonder how many people would have shown up if I hadn't noticed that there wasn't a Facebook event for today.
I know. It caused quite the stir. We kind of discussed it last week and then I kind of forgot about it. I think we all kind of forgot about it, right? So it worked out pretty well. We ended up with 21 people. It was good. Fun categories.
So I have co-host rights, which apparently means I can't copy the event. But once she created the event for me, I was able to rename it and put the correct time and date. And then I went in to invited everyone in Facebook who had attended the previous 5 trivias, sent them invites.
Oh, that's good. Good. That was good. I'm glad you did that.
So what I did last time, because I was trying to, I was like, it kicked in my super responsible part that comes out sometimes. I'm like, okay, we're responsible for next week and, you know, and are people going to come? So I actually went back and I looked at about 7 pictures from years ago. And then I looked up those people on Facebook and I invited them last week.
Good for you.
I was just trying to invite everybody. Maybe someone will come because it's a holiday.
That's right. Yeah.
It didn't happen.
We ended up having a pretty good turnout last week, though. A lot better than I thought.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was good. Yeah. And I can't host it next week because I will be in London.
Oh, what are you doing in London?
My husband has a business trip there and I'm going along because it won't.
Oh, the real London.
The real London.
Not the one in Ontario.
Not the one in Ontario. Yeah. Yeah, that one I still could host it. It seemed to just be up late, but London, England.
Right. It's, yeah, that's yeah. totally wrong time. It's
not Rob, gonna happen. So Rob has the ability to log on to Zoom, right?
Yes, he does.
And, do that. Okay.
Yeah. So Rob's if Susan's not back yet, then because I mean the conference is this weekend that she's going to, and I think she's speaking at a couple other places. So I'm thinking that maybe, and while I'm thinking of it, I am going to send her a note. When are you coming home? Do we need somebody for next week?
I see that interesting TikTok interview with that lovely person.
Melanie.
About
yeah.
Wicca pediatrician. Mm-hmm. But it was good and well done and the words and stuff. And but it had this weird filter on it that kind of like
it.
Smoothed out their faces. Mm-hmm. They looked a little ghostly.
Yeah, I didn't like the filter. I noticed that too, Karen. But yeah, the actual content was good.
Yeah, very yeah. good.
I'm putting, when are you coming home? Trivia needs to know.
Yes.
No other reason.
Yeah. That's the only thing you care about.
We don't and care anything else, just trivia.
And if Susan needs a break, like if she wants to, oh, we're still recording. If
oh, Susan, thanks.
Hi. If Susan wants a break sometime, we could